I'm Tom Reynolds, so I'm going to be talking about tidal disruption events. I think I'm the first of like three talks now, which are going to be focusing on tidal disruption events, or TDEs. But in particular, I'm going to be talking about observing them in the infrared. And even more particularly, hopefully, and highlight the results from the NOT, of course. I do want to comment, I have some co-authors here who would have wanted to be here but couldn't make it, who are big NOT users, obviously, Seth Bohm in particular. Yes, but he was busy. So, onwards then. I'm lucky enough to go first, so I get to give a short introduction of TDEs. What is a TDE? Well, here's the schematic from this old paper by Reese, where this was predicted as a phenomena. We have some star. It's coming a bit too close to some supermassive black hole for its comfort, and it goes inside the Roche radius, where the tidal forces from the supermassive black hole are going to be too strong, so for the star to be gravitationally bound together. And so it's torn apart. Because of the gravitational potential across the star, you get only about half of it staying actually bound to the black hole, and the rest flies off somewhere. And then when this bound material is accreted onto the black hole, there's going to be some sort of luminous flare, some sort of release of energy. You can work out just with some sort of simple mass of the star plus some efficiency calculation how much energy you expect to see, and it's this like 10 to the 53 ergs of energy. And then, both from theory and from what we've observed quite recently, there's a rate of these things in a normal galaxy that we expect, which is this 10 to the minus 4 per year. And again, I'm expecting some more details maybe in the future talks. Very quickly, again, this is the SED of maybe a typical TDE, although that's maybe definitely big inverted commas there. This is an object SASIN 14Li, which was a TDE observed quite early on, big example. So we have the SED, and this is like an incomplete SED, but I'll just highlight a few bits. Here's what the galaxy looked like, and then we have some soft X-rays that are coming from some accretion disk that's forming from the star that was disrupted. This is quite compact, and they're very hot. And then we have this UV and optical emission, which has kind of a black body of about 30,000 Kelvin or so, and it remains hot like for a very long time. And it's kind of much more extended, and this origin of what this is uncertain. I can't go into it here because it's not so relevant for my talk, but again, we'll probably hear more about it. So back onto the infrared, which is what I care about. What characterizes this emission from the TDE? Well, it's delayed. It doesn't come at the same time as the UV and the optical, for example. Now, the temperatures are something like these here, and then decline over time. This is kind of the peak. We can interpret this as an infrared echo, which comes from dust. So there's dust somewhere near the supermassive black hole. It's heated by the TDE, and it absorbs the light from here, basically. And then it re-emits in the infrared, and that's what we observe. So on to an actual example. This is an object transiting called ARP299B81. So this is a bit of a weirdo. It was discovered in the near-infrared. This was actually back in like 2005. And it wasn't luminous at all in the optical or in the X-rays. You didn't see anything there, so it must be very obscured. And this was then followed up in the infrared. This was my supervisor's work because I wasn't doing science in 2005. But here are the Spitzer light curves in the mid-infrared, and then all these green points here are actually with NOTCam and K-band. And this, if you look at this X-axis, this is 4,400 days. So this thing is real slow. It just evolves, just ticks away, and we just observe it with the NOT again and again and again. And so why do you do this? Well, one thing is you can get, you can fit your black bodies to what you see and get some temperatures and scales and measure the total radiated energy that you see. And you get this 10 to 52 erg at least, which is kind of in the realm of what we expect to see from a TDE. So is it a TDE? Well, we don't have too much information about it just from the infrared, but there's this big smoking gun which kind of is used to determine that this was a TDE, which is the radio data. I didn't mention, but obviously we've heard a lot about jets in the previous talks, and basically here what we see is in this nice galaxy, I'll talk about this kind of complicated galaxy in a second, but we see when you zoom in on this nucleus, there's a compact radio source in 2005, and then this is all like resolved with VLBI. And when you come back, you find this emission has moved off away and declines. And basically, this is interpreted as a pretty like a jet that's kind of angled towards the observer. It's like mildly relativistic. It decelerates quite fast. So, you know, we've launched the jets, but does that mean we have a TDE? Well, the kind of final piece of the puzzle here was that there's a type 2 AGN in this nucleus that we find both from some, I think, some hard X-rays and also from this fitting we do to the spectral and energy distribution of the galaxy. You know, that's the wrong inclination for this to be a jet associated with that accretion disk, if you kind of imagine this picture that we heard earlier of the type 2 AGN. So that was kind of the way the argument was put together. And this this was published in Science in 2018. So again, so I comment, this is ARP-299, this galaxy. You can see it's super complicated, merging, star forming. It's a luminous infrared galaxy, which was mentioned a little bit earlier, I think. There's very quickly, what are these things? Here's an example of a really beautiful one. They're complicated systems. They're unsurprisingly luminous in the infrared. And the luminosity is coming from warm dust. It's heated by either young stars or an AGN or both. Why are they interesting in the context of TDEs? Well, they're nearly all, well, not nearly all, but 50% interacting galaxies or merging galaxies. And you can turn up the TDE rate in galaxies that are merging. There are some kind of recent papers on this about if you have dual supermassive black holes, you can do this very efficiently, I think, but also just having more stars around can turn up the TDE rates. Also, these are things, the real reason we actually discovered this nuclear transient is we were looking for supernovae, because these things, like ARP-299 has maybe one supernova a year because the star formation rate's so high. But the supernova hide behind the dust, so you've got to look in the near infrared if you want to find them. So this wasn't a one-off, which was the weird thing. So we were still looking, as I said, for obscured supernovae in these lergs, and we found another transient, this AT2017 GBL. And there's some things that are quite similar. It's luminous in the infrared again, and it's luminous in the radio. It's further away, so we can't get nice resolved radio data, but still luminous. And again, it's quite faint in the optical, although we do detect it. This is a little optical data here. And again, we really hammered this with NOTCam. This time, the x-axis is only about 3 years, kind of 800 days, so it evolves a lot more quickly. We have to decide what this is. And we don't have this jet, so it's a little more tricky. And actually, the objects Tapio was talking about, these changing look AGNs, are also could be invoked as what's causing this. But we go for a dust-obscured TDE in the kind of similar scenario as the most plausible. And what we think is really interesting, one point is that because you have, again, you have nice JHK data, you can fit your black bodies, and you can have very well-determined temperatures with small error bars, and you can actually do a little fit with some kind of basic modeling, and you can determine things like the luminosity of the flare that caused this thing, which I'll discuss a bit more later. So, interestingly, we can get a rate from this, because this was part of a little survey to look for these obscured supernovae. So you get a rate, and it's, here are the numbers, 10 to the minus 1.4 to minus 2.8, so big uncertainty, but this is much, much higher than this TDE rate that we expect. So the question is, are we, therefore finding more TDEs in lergs? Is this some hidden population of TDEs? Well, we went looking for more with this NEOWISE survey. So NEOWISE is this satellite. It's observing the whole sky every 6 months in 3.4 and 4.6 micron bands, so in the mid-infrared. And so we went looking, we found three more transients in lergs, in particular this nice one here. This is the W1 kind of light curves in luminosity. Again, these red points are this ARP-299 transient I mentioned, and these blue points are this new one we discovered in this in the NEOWISE data. So again, you can derive another rate, and it's kind of similar, but with slightly nice errors. And there is, of course, a little bit more of a problem with determining what these things are. We have very little data on them. Additionally, all we have really are these two mid-infrared points, so you can't really get good temperatures. Like you see when this guy at the hottest, we have a huge error bar on our temperature measurement because you don't have NOTCam anymore. But yeah, so this is a paper I just kind of accepted right now, actually. But you can check it out in the archive. So here is our kind of the picture of what we think was happening with these things. So we have our collaborator, Andreas Estethiou. There's this great radiative transfer modeling of the spectral energy distribution of these galaxies, and you can decompose and look inside them and find out if there's an AGN in there. And there just kind of always is in these objects, some sort of AGN contribution, and in particular this type 2 inclination angle where we're looking into the torus. So, you know, if you imagine your transient here, you can't see the direct emission from the TDE. It's just completely obscured. And so we invoke these polar clouds as the kind of the source of the infrared echo. So you get maybe a little optical light if you scatter some off the polar clouds, but otherwise you're restricted to seeing this infrared here. And this is supported by the fact that when you do this spectral energy distribution fitting here, this is the polar dust in the fit, and then you look at the post-transient fit, all you got to do is turn up the polar dust, and it makes it work. That's the idea. So this is our scenario. So I want to connect this back now to the kind of more typical TDEs and our more recent work that's kind of quite exciting. So you do observe infrared echoes in optical TDEs. Oh, great, I'm ahead of time then. So you do observe infrared echoes in kind of normal TDEs, but it's a bit of a different situation because they're in quiescent galaxies, right? So you don't have your AGN, you don't have your radiation destroying the dust that's close to the supermassive black hole. So then the TDE gets the chance to destroy the dust instead. So when your TDE goes off, it'll destroy the dust out to some distance where the dust just can't survive the intense radiation. And then at some distance, the radiation will be weak enough, the dust can survive. And there'll be a time delay. That's where the time delay in the infrared arises in these objects, because the infrared emission should only really start when the dust can survive. At that point, it's heated to this sublimation temperature, which is something like 1,500 to 2,000 Kelvin, depends on the grain size and the composition of the dust and these things. So what you can do is you can do some modeling with this, and so if you have the optical light curves of the TDE, and you have some infrared data, you can put together this model, and you can determine quite a lot of stuff. You can find this sublimation radius, and kind of tells you where the dust is, maybe 0.1 parsec away. And then what you can also do is you can determine the intrinsic luminosity of the flare from the TDE at the wavelengths where dust is an efficient absorber because of this sublimation radius, right? So if it's more luminous, this will be larger. If it's less luminous, this should be smaller. So if you can measure the sublimation radius well by sampling the rise and the fall of this light curve, then you can evaluate the TDE precisely. And this is important because when you observe the observations that have been done for these optically discovered TDEs, find that the actual total energy that gets radiated is too small compared to this 10 to the 53 ergs that I mentioned earlier. There's kind of energy to find. And so looking in the infrared, you find more energy, and you can kind of convert this back to the actual intrinsic luminosity of the flare. There's also this question of the covering factor, i.e. how much dust was there? Like, what's the ratio of the luminosity in the infrared to the luminosity in the kind of optical and UV? You can do that like just very simple measurements, and you find the covering factor in optical TDEs is like 1% or less in like pretty much all of the previous ones, which means there's just not really any dust there. There's some, but there's only a little dust there, which is a very different scenario than in our case, the case of these lurgs. This is probably a bit of a selection effect because people want to classify TDEs, and so they look for very blue things, and so if there's any little bit of extinction, then maybe the TDEs aren't getting classified. So if we want to do this better, we need to improve some things. Because you look at this, this is just two wise points and some upper limits. And then you can get these parameters out, but you get the very large uncertainties. You have to assume the dust temperature. You have to assume everything about the dust. But you can't measure things very precisely. So this comes on to our very exciting NOT program that we're running at the moment. And this is, we don't really have results yet because it only started about a year ago. What we're doing is we're just observing every optically classified TDE with NOTCam. And this is like a soft EOO program, which I think is the only NOTCam soft EOO program. It's a little bit awkward because NOTCam's not always mounted, but it works very nicely for us because we don't need like super great cadence. But it is a lot better cadence than the 6 months that you would get with NEOWISE. So if you have better cadence, you can actually sample the rise and the fall of the infrared light curve, which was missing from NEOWISE. The other thing is that when the black body of the dust is hot, it's kind of like this. This is where the NEOWISE filters are, and this is obviously our near-infrared filters. So if you want to actually measure the temperature, you've got to sample the peak, and NEOWISE doesn't do this. And obviously, it's only 2 points, and so you don't get great errors if you only have 2 points, right, for your temperature. And so this is one of our ones where we've detected an infrared echo, and it's quite bizarre because like this is like 20 days after the classification of the TDE. We already detect an infrared echo, and then it was declining afterwards, which is way too fast. So it's a little bit perplexing, actually. So we're looking forward to getting templates of this and trying to work out what's happening. And additionally, we're discovering these infrared echoes. We expected maybe 33%, but so far we're discovering many infrared echoes in these optical TDEs. So this is very exciting, and we're continuing this program, and hopefully we'll have more concrete results quite soon, because these things need to fade and we need to get templates. So that's all everything I wanted to say. Just to conclude, there are TDEs hiding in lurgs, basically. NOTCam means that we can observe them better than just using these free resources with NEOWISE. And then, of course, if it's not obvious, NTE is just like amazing for this stuff, right? We get optical, we get infrared at the same time, so we get the SED, and then it's always mounted, so we get the cadence we want. And then also, there's this question of near-infrared spectra, where there's like one, maybe two near-infrared spectra of TDEs. So that's going to be quite exciting to explore. Oh, and finally, this is me in the distant past as a student at the NOT, 7 years ago. I thought I'd contribute my student photo there. So great, thanks. Any questions?